even though the rules for training when cutting aren't as clearly defined as they are for nutrition, there are still a few principles that any workout routine must be based around if you want to see great fat loss results. I've come up with a training system that will ensure that you're getting the best results possible without having to give up on living an enjoyable lifestyle in the process. This system is composed of three different lifting pillars, which are 1, the main pillar, 2, the assistance pillar, and 3, the progression pillar. If you want to do a successful cut, then you should base your weight training around these 3 lifting pillars. So, without further ado, let's start by looking at the main pillar. The most effective way to build a lean and muscular physique is by focusing your energy on getting insanely strong on just a handful of lifts. And that's exactly what the main pillar is all about. In this pillar, all the fluff is cut out, meaning no time will be spent doing junk volume on unnecessary exercises. This is first and foremost so that you are able to recover from your training while you are stripping off body fat. Because a calorie deficit, which is required for fat loss, is also a recovery deficit. And if you are not able to recover when cutting, then it's bye-bye to both strength and muscle mass. Secondly, the fluff is removed so that you can save time and energy towards enjoying your physique outside of the gym as well. I strongly believe that building a great looking lean and muscular body should add value to your life and not the other way around. Unless you are looking to compete in bodybuilding, why else would you even build it in the first place? So with that said, let's get started with the first component of the main pillar, which is setting up your compound lifts. It's been shown repeatedly that nothing beats the effectiveness of doing compound lifts for strength and physique development. The reason for this is that you can lift the most amount of weight with compound lifts. Compound lifts stresses the whole body as one, and by doing compound lifts, you use a range of motion that is very natural to the body. By doing heavy bench presses, overhead presses, pull-ups, rows, deadlifts, and squats, you will stress your whole body as one, and in doing so, get the largest stimulus for growth. Another important reason for utilizing big compound exercises is to create a symmetrical and proportional physique. By doing large compound lifts, you will develop your body as one, which is crucial for creating a great looking body. Way too many people, especially beginners, believe that to build big arms or a big back or a big chest, they just have to focus on those muscle groups with isolation exercises. But unfortunately, doing so won't work very well. Now, why is that? Well, let me answer that with a question. Have you ever seen someone with huge 18-inch arms who also has a small upper body? Someone who looks like this? Well, at least I haven't. In fact, everything is big on the guy with 18-inch arms. His back, chest, shoulders, and even legs are going to be very well developed. He might look something like this. You see, getting strong on big compound lifts makes your whole body bigger, including any specific muscles you want to grow as well. With that said though, there are still a time and place for isolation exercises, and we will cover when that is later in the video. But before doing so, let's look at the second component of the main pillar, which is to dial in the correct training volume. The main driver behind muscle growth is training volume, which is the amount of work that you do. Meaning the more work that you can do while still being able to recover, the more your muscles will grow. Now, with that said, since your goal during a cutting phase is fat loss, you must make sure that you are not training too much. And this is very important. This is important because of something called the work to recovery ratio. In order to build muscle, or at least preserve muscle when cutting, you must first provide a stimulus for growth, which is done via challenging resistance training. After that, you must recover. This is where your body repairs itself from the stress and damage inflicted by the challenging resistance training. And this is done with rest, food, and sleep. When training and recovery are balanced out with each other, that's when you preserve or even build muscle. So, in order to get great fat loss results when cutting, you must make sure that you are training just enough to support muscle growth, but not too much so that you are unable to recover. So, the question becomes, how do you do this? Well, you set up your training to do the least amount of volume you can get away with, while still keeping your strength. So, how do you know how much training volume you should do then? Well, to preserve muscle mass, some research and anecdotal evidence shows that for most people, training with only 6 effective sets per body part per week is enough to maintain your current level of muscularity. With that said, during some circumstances, it's possible to gain a bit of muscle during a cutting phase, especially in the beginning. That's why doing a bit more volume is favorable to start off with. So, the training volume I recommend when cutting are between 6 to 10 effective sets per muscle group per week. Note that this recommendation refers to effective sets per week. To understand what effective sets means, let's take a look at the next component of the main pillar, which is setting up your repetition range. When cutting, it's very important that you get the most bang for your buck. This is so that you can get the most amount of effective work in while still being able to recover. Now, there are 3 main factors that leads to muscle growth. 1, mechanical tension. This is tension on the muscles created by lifting heavy weights with low to moderate reps. 2. Metabolic fatigue. This is the burn you feel when you're doing high reps. And 3. Muscle damage. This is how much you break down your muscles during training. So both pumping your muscles and lifting heavy weights will lead to muscle growth, but what's important to know is that they won't do so equally. It turns out that progressively increasing mechanical tension over time is by far the most effective factor for muscle growth, which tells us that if you are not getting stronger over time, then you won't grow bigger muscles very effectively either. I'm sure you have noticed this yourself, where if someone currently is as strong as they were last year, they are probably the same size too. However, what's worth mentioning is that strength and size is correlated only when strength is gained in a medium rep range. That's why some individuals who aren't that big and muscular can still lift extremely heavy weights. For example, both powerlifters and Olympic weightlifters train their nervous system to produce high amounts of force for one rep. They also use form that gives them the best mechanical advantage. But to get the most effective stimulus for muscle growth, on the other hand, I recommend training in the 4 to 10 repetition range on your compound lifts. Training within the 4 to 10 repetition range on your compound exercises with 3 to 5 minutes of rest in between is perfect when it comes to maximizing muscle growth during a cutting phase. Okay, so the last component included in the main pillar is to train 3, max 4 days per week. There are 3 reasons why training 3, max 4 days per week are beneficial. Number 1 is recovery. Number 2 is optimal muscle group frequency, and number 3 is time for enjoying life. Let's start by looking at recovery first. When it comes to building muscle as a natural trainee, meaning no external help from sources like anabolic steroids or anti-catabolics, etc., then, as I mentioned earlier, the thing that will make or break your physique will be your work to rest ratio. And that's the first reason why training only 3 to 4 days per week is very smart when cutting. Since you need to be in a calorie deficit to lose body fat, you can provide the body with food to recover better. But instead, what you can do is give the body a few days where it's completely free from training, where it can better recuperate itself even though there's absence of calories. Okay, so the second reason why we want to train only 3 max 4 days per week is because of optimal muscle group frequency. When it comes to building muscle naturally, to get the best results possible, you need to optimize your muscle group training frequency. This scientific review clearly shows that for a natural trainee, spreading out your total training volume on 2 to 3 days throughout the week is superior to doing all the work only once per week. The reason for this is number 1, more frequent elevation of muscle protein synthesis by training a muscle 2 to 3 times per week. And number 2, more volume can be performed by spreading out the work over multiple sessions. And the third reason for training 3 max 4 days per week was to provide yourself with more time for enjoying life. As I said earlier, building your physique should add value to your life and not steal from it. That's a big reason why we keep training to only 3 or 4 days per week. Now, if you absolutely love training more than anything else, then by all means go ahead and train more often. But make sure that you are still able to recover and that you are also training with a good muscle group frequency, so you at least get optimal results from the time invested. Okay, so that's it regarding the main pillar. Let's move on to the assistance pillar. The goal when setting up a training program for cutting is to utilize the easiest and most effective strategies and methods to create a ripped physique, as this will allow you to recover and feel great during your fat loss phase. To achieve this, the best thing would be if you could only rely on the main pillar, but unfortunately, you wouldn't get the best results using only that pillar. That's why I created the assistance pillar, to fill in the gap that the main pillar misses. Fortunately though, I have found a method that makes this pillar very effective and enjoyable as well. Now, before looking at the method, the main reason why we need to use isolation and assistance exercises in the first place is because there's one muscle group in particular that needs to be isolated in order to be trained, and that's your medial or side delts. If you leave them underdeveloped, you will lose out on a huge part of what makes up an aesthetic physique. In fact, shoulder development is one of the biggest contributors to an overall aesthetic body. The crux with your medial delts is that they're used in a very specific way that doesn't let them get hit effectively by any of your compound lifts. Not even overhead presses hit your medial delts well enough. The only way to train them effectively is when you extend your arms out to the sides. This movement puts your shoulders in a very bad position to lift heavy weights, risking injury. For that reason, you need to use lighter weights and higher reps to train your side delts safely and effectively. Another reason for using isolation or assistance exercises are for certain muscle groups that need a bit more training to grow. This is typically biceps or rear delts, which are also huge components of an aesthetic physique. Another muscle group that should be trained with isolation exercises are the ones who people think are made in the kitchen. Yes, you guessed it, I'm talking about your abs. Abs are revealed in the kitchen, but just as with any other muscle, they are made in the gym. Now, heavy compound lifts will train your abs, but they will mainly train your internal stabilizing abs such as your transverse abdominis and your internal obliques. In order to get that six-pack to really pop when you're lean, you must train your rectus abdominis directly, which is done with ab flexion exercises such as crunches and leg raises, for example. Now, to effectively add this extra work for these muscle groups, I have found a training technique that's extremely effective and enjoyable. The technique is called myo reps. The main reason why I love myo reps is because it's a quick and highly effective method to get the work in. By utilizing myo reps, you take advantage of rest periods to create a training stimulus that is better than what you can achieve with the standard approach. That takes you around 2/3 of the time, and that also leaves you with an incredible pump. I've written a complete guide about myo reps that you can read on my website. Link is down in the description if you want to check it out. But in short, here's how it works. First, you do an activation set where you start with the weight that you can get between 12 to 15 reps with. Then do as many reps as you can until you are at the brink of failure. Then you rest for 10 to 15 seconds. After the rest, you do a quote-unquote mini set until you are at the brink of failure again. Then you rest for another 10 to 15 seconds. And after this rest, you do another mini set until you are at the brink of failure once again. You repeat this process until you no longer can get the same amount of reps on all your mini sets, or you stop once you have reached 5 sets in total. The reason this works so well is because we know that the closer we come to muscular failure, the more each rep will contribute to muscle growth. We also know that there is a certain threshold of effort that we must pass in order for a rep to start to stimulate muscle growth. Once we pass this threshold, our reps start to become effective reps. We can get these effective reps in any rep range, but according to research, the threshold where effective reps start to accumulate seems to be at around 60% of max exertion. What makes myo reps so effective is the short rest times. By taking only 10 to 15 seconds of rest between your sets, you will start working with effective reps immediately from the moment you pick up the weight. Just think about it. If you, for example, were to do 12 to 15 reps the standard way, meaning with 2 to 3 minutes of rest in between, then the first 7 to 8 reps of the exercise is going to be so easy that you will just go through the motion and not actually get any productive work from the time and movement invested. With myo reps, on the other hand, each of these mini sets that you do will be like starting on rep 8 to 10. This means that immediately from the first rep, you will do effective work that causes muscle growth. Okay, so before finishing up this video, let's look at the last but definitely not least pillar in the system, which is the progression pillar. The progression pillar is a must, no matter how you choose to train. If you want to effectively build or at least preserve muscle when cutting, you must try your best to make progress with your training and get stronger over time. This holds true even if you're in a calorie deficit where progression is harder to achieve. Getting stronger over time is known as progressive overload, and is ultimately what will build you that muscular physique that will drop people's jaws when your shirt comes off. In fact, one of the biggest mistakes people typically make is that they are only using a training split or routine, but they don't care about progressive overload. Making sure that you get stronger over time is the most important aspect of the entire training program when it comes to transforming your physique. Just think about it. If you can lift 100 pounds for sets of 6 today, and a year from now you can still only lift the same 100 pounds for sets of 6, then why would your body need any additional muscle? On the other hand, if 1 year from now you can lift 200 pounds for sets of 6, then your body had to get bigger for you to be able to lift that. So the question becomes, how do you make sure that you're getting stronger over time? Well, the best progression model that I found is called double progression, which works well all the way from beginner to late intermediate status, which would be 0 to 4 years of solid strength training. And here's how it works. Make sure that you pause the video and note down this progression model and then start using it in the gym. Okay, so there you have it, the three pillars required for setting up a successful weight training program when cutting. If you want to learn more about training when cutting and also get a complete training program to follow, which is based entirely on the principles mentioned in this video, then make sure you go to ironbuildfitness.com/train-on-cut. I hope to see you on the website, and if not, I will see you in the next video. Bye.